So, as solvents go, there's basically three general categories that they fall under. The first would be polar solvents, okay? And this has to do back with when we talked about dipoles a really, really long time ago. You still have to remember that. Polar solvents are just the same way that we determined what a polar solvent was at the beginning when we talked about dipoles. It's the same thing here. It's a molecule that has a net dipole. So just go ahead and write that down. Okay? So molecules with net dipoles would be polar solvents. Then we have two different types of solvents. We have aprotic solvents and protic solvents. And this I have to define because we've never really used that word before. So basically, the essence of a protic solvent is one that can hydrogen bond. Okay? So if you're able to donate hydrogen because you are oxygen, nitrogen, or fluorine, that will be considered a protic solvent. Okay? So you might already guess that an aprotic solvent would be one that cannot display hydrogen bonding. Okay, so let's go ahead and write that down. And then that means that a protic solvent is going to be a solvent that displays H bonding. And that H bonding has a special property. It turns out that for different types of reactions, it's going to have different effects. So for when you're making carbocations, if you can hydrogen bond, that's actually going to stabilize the carbocation and make it easier to generate a carbocation for that step. So be thinking about that, okay? There's another thing that they do. They also tend to slow down nucleophiles. So imagine that you have this negative charge and you've got all of these waters sticking to it. It's going to make that negative charge a little slower through the solution and a little bit more difficult to donate its electrons. So it kind of has the same effect for both the positive charge and the negative charge. The problem is that for the positive charge, it's a good thing to stabilize it. For the negative charge, it's a bad thing because it winds up hindering it and making it more bulky. Okay? So if we were to think about the type of solvents that we would use for mechanisms, we've learned four mechanisms so far: SN1, SN2, E1, and E2. What kind of mechanisms would I prefer to have a protic solvent in? Okay? Think about what protic means. That means it can hydrogen bond. So what would be a good mechanism to have with a protic solvent? Good. So it would be one that has carbocations, so that would be SN1 and E1. Are you guys following the logic there? Because protic solvents are going to be able to stabilize the carbocation, as I said before, up here. Okay? And then that means that in an aprotic solvent, what would be a good mechanism to run? And that would be SN2 and E2, because these are mechanisms that start off. Remember, the very first step is a strong nucleophile attacks something. So do I want a protic solvent to bulk that, to make it bulky and to slow it down? No, I actually want an aprotic solvent so it's not going to hinder it at all and it's just going to zip right through the solvent. All right? So does that kind of make sense, the distinction we're using? That's the kind of question that you could see in a conceptual question on your exam. All right? So now what I want to do for the rest of this page is just go through these eight solvents, and this will kind of be a combination of identifying solvents and also just a teaching moment for you guys to learn a few common solvents that we use in all of organic chemistry. Not just one, we're going to use these solvents for Orgo 1 and for Orgo 2. So we'll go ahead and we'll just have a different answer for every one. So you guys just go ahead and take your time with number one and figure out, is it apolar or is it polar protic or polar aprotic? So basically you have three options. You just have to check off one of the boxes. All right? And the way you're going to look at that is look at the dipole and then determine if it can hydrogen bond or not. All right? So go ahead and try to figure it out.